this matchup tonight. Alabama leads the series versus Auburn 95-65, and Alabama hoping for a big win tonight against a really good basketball team. But Brian Pasek joins us now. Brian, always great to have you in. Thanks for being with us.
Great to be with you guys, and also awesome to be on with you and Scott Moore, obviously, Antonio as well. But I still have my Scott Moore and Jay Barker T-shirt from a long time ago, from WYDE 850, which was a couple years ago. But great memories, and really the first time that I had ever been on the radio. So and ended up getting the gig at Alabama, and you guys have jump-started my very mediocre broadcasting career, and
yeah,
I'm forever grateful.
Right. Yeah, you made it 19 years, my friend. It's always good hearing from you, Brian. And listen, you're a great ambassador for Alabama basketball, what you do. And and you and Chris Stewart are one of the best radio teams in all of college basketball. And I've said this many times, and I've said it to your face, but I don't know anybody that knows basketball better than Brian. Brian is one of the best analysts out there, but loves the game. I mean, studies the game, knows what he's talking about. So anytime we could talk to Brian Pasek about basketball, it's a great. But hey, Auburn coming into town to Brian tonight. Coleman's probably going to get sold out. This is a big one. Auburn unbeaten, maybe the best team in the SEC, one of the four best in the country. Hey, break it down for us, buddy.
Well, first of all, thank you for those kind words, and really looking forward to tonight. It's going to be a lot of fun. It always is when Alabama and Auburn get together, and extra special considering how good Auburn is right now. They've been one of the best teams in the country. I had a chance to watch them play on several occasions this year, and they're really impressive. Got some new faces, but the talent level has not dropped off from a year ago. They play a little different. They're going to play hard. They're going to push the ball in transition, rebound the ball at a high level on both ends of the floor. But they're really good. They've got some guys now that do the job a little more around the basket than what they had last year, a more perimeter-oriented attack. But, gosh, you can't sell short the guards that have come in this year and played extremely well. I mean, those guys are so balanced. They're really good, and I know both teams are going to be excited to play each other, and should be a great atmosphere tonight in Coleman Coliseum.
What's the biggest difference you've seen in the play of this team with Nate Oates than what you've seen in the past?
Well, the style of play is obviously radically different than we've seen in a number of years in Alabama. And it's one of the reasons Greg Burns went out and got one of the hottest coaches in the country. It wasn't just because of Nate Oates' success. Obviously, that's a major part of it. He's one of the best mid-major coaches in recent years in the entire country. But that, along with the style of play, knew that this would be something that fans would get excited about, that current players would want to be a part of, and recruits would want to come in and play this style. And we're starting to see it for a couple of different reasons. One is these guys are getting more comfortable with how they're expected to play, when to push it, when to hold back, when to try to get in a gap, and when to let the play develop. Those things don't happen overnight. It takes some time. And it's starting to come around. So the offense has been much better. And I think maybe even more important than that is this team is as healthy as it's been all year long. Early in the season, you had a couple guys out with ACLs. Obviously, they're still out, lost for the year. But then you add in Alex Reese with a bad hip and ankle. Herbert Jones with a hyperextended elbow, missed a lot of time. Beadle Bolden, the team's only senior, missed about 3 weeks of practice and a couple of games with a bad wrist, his left wrist, which is his shooting hand. So those things set you back, especially with as difficult as this non-conference portion of the schedule was. But guys are getting healthy. They're getting a little more used to the offense, and they're getting better defensively. So all those things is a really good recipe for success, and it has Alabama playing much better basketball. Now, a couple of these losses, especially on the road, were disappointing from the outcome standpoint, but encouraging with how they played in Gainesville, Florida. Really should have won that game. Going on the road to play Kentucky, one of the toughest places to play, obviously, in college basketball, not shooting it well, but still having a chance to win. So I think this team comes in confident and playing well.
We are with Brian Pasek, who will be on the call tonight when Auburn and Alabama play in Colon Coliseum. Brian, I want to get your just perspective from on Alabama from about 10,000 feet and just their season overall. They're 8-7, 1-2 in the SEC. Are they meeting expectations so far, or would you label what's transpired as mildly disappointing, or is it just a team that is trying to find itself and really get used to this new style of play that Nate Oates has brought?
Yeah, I think it's a little more complicated from the standpoint of, if you would have asked me before the season, at this point, would 8-7 or with the record where it is today be disappointing? I would say I would have thought this team would be a little further ahead in terms of their record, but the reality of how injured this team has been, and you know, the thing that I love about these players and coaches, they don't use that as an excuse, but as an analyst, I see the majority of the team not able to practice for 3 weeks in the schedule that they played. And to be able to navigate through that and keep their head above water, the record is not what you want it to be. But when I look at what this team is doing on the court since they've got into conference play, and even a couple games before that, the level that they're playing at, the effort, the improvement in really all areas, they're taking care of the ball much better. They're defending at a higher level, rebounding the ball at a higher level. When you look at those three guys that I mentioned that missed a lot of time, especially practice time with injuries, now that they've come back to practice, they played much better basketball. So I love the way they're playing. I wish the record was a little better right now. I think Coach Oates would tell you the same thing. But because the league is so good and there's so many opportunities like tonight, you still can get things going in the right direction. And if this team continues to improve and plays the way they have, if shots fall against the number four team in the country tonight, Alabama's going to have a great chance to get a huge win and really catapult them into the rest of the SEC.
Yeah, and you look at, as far as you brought it up, as the turnovers, 15 and a half per game right now for Alabama. Nate Oates has really stressed this, but I'm sure he'll really stress it tonight. They love, Auburn does, to get the turnovers and get out in transition as quick as possible.
Yeah, you got to take care of the ball against Auburn. They're so balanced. They're really efficient offensively. They create turnovers on the defensive end, and both teams want to get out and run. I think both coaches, all the players on both sides, I think they're really excited to play this game because there's a lot of similarities with the way each team wants to play, especially on the offensive end. It ought to be fun. It ought to be up-tempo. Both teams need to take care of the ball. But that's where Alabama, I think, has shown as much improvement as anybody in the SEC is ball security. Always important, but especially so against the Auburn Tigers with their ability to get out in transition.
Talking to Brian Pasek of the Crimson Tide Sports Network. He'll be on the call tonight with Chris Stewart. Last loss for the Auburn Tigers, you guys know when it was? In the Final Four buzzer beater against Virginia. That's the last time Auburn lost a ball game. So tonight, Brian, a great atmosphere at Coleman. I think Alabama has been waiting at home for this kind of environment. We haven't kind of seen this in the last couple of years. There's real excitement about tonight's game. A lot of people trying to come down there and fill the coffers a little bit. I think the atmosphere tonight, 8 o'clock start, shouldn't keep a lot of people from not getting there. I like these 8 o'clock starts. The 6 o'clock starts are difficult to get to. Should be just an emotionally, electrically charged environment tonight. One that, quite frankly, we hadn't seen down there in a while.
Yeah, you know, there's been some big games over the years. I mean, last year's SEC opener against Kentucky was one that they were hanging from the rafters. And before that game, electric atmosphere, Alabama was able to get the win, and the home crowd had a lot to do with that. Hopefully, that'll be the case tonight. Anytime you play, and you know, you guys know this, whether it's football, basketball, whatever, rivalry game packed building, packed stadium. Emotions are so high. These are the games that you almost have to settle yourself down as opposed to getting yourself psyched up. I don't think anybody's going to have a problem with getting excited to play this game, but you got to settle down and execute the game plan and be under control emotionally, because these guys are going to be fired up on both sides. I mean, this is a big game for both schools. It's you know, the top 15 or top five team coming in, 15-0. These are the games that you get excited to play, and hopefully Alabama will continue to play well. And unlike the Kentucky game, hopefully shots will fall from the three-point line for Alabama.
Through 15 games, Brian, who would your MVP be of this Alabama team?
Well, I think John Petty has been the most improved player that I've seen in the SEC. And he was one that when there was a coaching change, he immediately put his name in the transfer portal. And about 5 seconds after he met Nate Oates and realized the style of play and how well he would fit in and how much he wanted to be a part of it, he took his name out. And what a great decision for John. And as an Alabama guy, thankful he did that, because it's been fun to watch his growth, his maturity. He's turned in to a complete player. Coming in as a freshman, he could shoot it, but was up and down. Wasn't the greatest defender, rebounded every now and then, and now he's the team's leading rebounder. He's one of the best defensive players in the SEC, one of the best three-point shooters in the SEC, and he's also become a team leader in the locker room, on the court. Whether he shoots the ball well or not, he's making an impact in the game on both ends of the floor, and I think more importantly, from a leadership standpoint. It's been so much fun to watch his growth and maturation over the course of his career. But there's some other candidates, but John Petty would be hard to beat.
Brian, always great to have you on, my man. It's going to be a great matchup tonight, and should be both teams running up and down the court. A lot of points looks to be scored tonight, but we really appreciate you being with us and breaking it down.
All right, guys. Always enjoy it. Thanks for having me.
I'm my man Brian Passing, color analyst and former player for the Crimson Tide, now color analyst on the Crimson Tide Network, with Chris Stewart calling the game tonight against the Auburn Tigers at Coleman Coliseum. I will continue live from AVX. You're listening to the Jay Barker Show, audio video excellence. We'll be back.
You're listening to the Jay Barker Show, live from the AVX studios in downtown Birmingham.
The law offices of Morrison Spann LLC, well-established law firm located in Columbia, Alabama. I've known Jonathan Spann for a while, can do a great job for you, and provides a wide range of quality, cost-effective legal services to clients throughout Alabama and throughout the Southeast. They strive to meet the legal needs of their clients individually and their families, and also small businesses, by offering personalized service that allows them to understand each client's individual needs. You can find them at 101 North Main Street, Columbia, Alabama. You can also give them a call at 205-669-2820. That's 205-669-2820, and you can also go online and check it out on their website, morrisonspann.com. That's Morrison, S-P-A-N-N, .com. And again, they just do a terrific job when it comes to any of the legal services, things that you might need when it comes to you and your family. So I want to remind you to make sure that you get that done, and also just remind you about the morrisonspann.com. Again, that's morrisonspann.com to find out more information. No representations made that the legal services provided by these guys are more better than the
that's about how it sounds. I think you should record that.
Wasn't that good?
Yeah.
But they don't.
Antonio,
I'm going to say it one more time. Yeah, no representation right. Made that the quality of legal service to be performed is greater than the quality of the services performed by the lawyers. There you go.
All right. But now
I love how they speed that thing up so fast.
They do, man. Tony Curry can do that perfectly.
Oh my gosh. Unbelievable. But Jonathan, those guys are great.
Now that Najee Harris has made it official and that he's returning to school, Antonio, are you surprised that Najee is coming back?
I'm not surprised. I'm just, I don't understand why it took so long to make the announcement. This has almost been, what, 3 weeks now? We've been going about you deciding if you're going to turn pro or not. It takes too long. Look, make the decision and let's move on from it. I mean, it's good that he's coming back. It's good for the university. It's good for the program. And it's definitely good for him to come back and, you know, have another good year and improve his stock as far as the draft is concerned. So him coming back, I mean, he took the time to make the decision with his family and everybody else that needed to be made. He had his conversation with Coach Saban. I just think it takes too long. If you knew, if you know what's going on, why push it so long?
I'll tell you what's interesting, though. I think all of us, when the season was going on, you were like, yeah, Najee's gone, Tua's gone, and absolutely number four, Jerry Jeudy. Those were the three you were like, yeah, those three guys are gone, and we'll see what happens the rest of the way. And for them to get him back and Moses back and Devontae Smith back and Alex Leatherwood back, we talked about this in the first hour. I mean, it's huge. I mean, because it's a senior. And, I mean, he is the best back in the conference right now, I think. Coming off a great year, the last half of the season, outstanding receiving and rushing. Had some really big games. Big game against Auburn. Big game against Michigan. So, you know, for Alabama's offense, I mean, you're going to have real strong, as Antonio said earlier, really great leadership on this team offensively. Production. You don't have to go ask Najee to say anything. Najee does it with his work ethic and his ability on the field. And so I just think this is huge getting number 22 back. I mean, you can't put a premium on that.
Yeah, I'm surprised, frankly, that he's coming back because during the season we all felt that he was gone.
Yeah.
And, you know, I made the comment that, hey, these are money games coming up for Najee Harris. And there were a few games there midway through the season after Tua went down where Najee Harris was the best offensive player on the field for Alabama. And, you know, I guess he just must have gotten reports back from the NFL that he wasn't going to be.
He got a third round grade, or later.
Yeah. And I think it also hurt. You had several other players declare, several other running backs. And running back is no longer a premium position in the NFL. And so,
like, maybe changing the way Derrick Henry's doing it right now.
I'm telling you, man.
Well, I know. Derrick.
And we were talking about that. When Marcus Mariota was at quarterback, the system they ran with him was not the right system for Derrick Henry. Derrick Henry's not a side-to-side guy. He is a downhill runner. And when Tannehill went in, that's when they looked at it and said, okay, we've got to go back to this play-action pass off downhill runs and let him press the hole, do the things he does, cutbacks, all that. And he's been outstanding.
Are you surprised by Tannehill's emergence, Jay?
Well, I mean, he was the number one pick. He was a guy that
They got him for a sixth-round pick.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah. I mean, again, it's a lot of it's system, and they're not asking him to do too much. But at the same time, when he has to make the plays, he's making the throws down the field.
We're looking at some of them right now. Yeah. And I'll tell you also the emergence of A.J. Brown, a big physical receiver that can go get it. They've got some really good weapons, their offensive line. But, Antonio, I'll tell you what's interesting, man. They went to New England and won that ball game. And Derrick Henry, 190 yards. And then last week, against a team that everybody thought was going to win the Super Bowl.
Yep.
I mean, they went in there and dominated the ball game, and so you can kind of go, okay, this running back thing and running the ball and stopping the run in this day and age of throw the ball all over the field and score a lot of points, and that works. But man, Antonio, running the football, and you're trying to tackle Derrick Henry in the third and fourth quarter, and you got to get off the field. It's really, really hard to do with a guy that's 6'4", 200. I mean, Derrick Henry's got away, in my opinion, got away over 250 pounds. That guy is huge.
Yeah.
Defensively, as a defensive coordinator, I tell my guys, look, I'm not going to sit here and say we're going to be able to stop him. Our job is to try to contain him and make some plays and get off the field on third down. Because most of the time, you know what's going to – the Titans, their game plan is to give you a heavy dose of Derrick Henry.
35 times.
Yes, a heavy dose of Derrick Henry. And if you can stop – Derrick Henry and the Tennessee Titans run game, I think they become they're one dimensional. They're just a run team. They have some receivers, but their receivers have not been big time receivers that would scare you in the game.
You got to do it with play action.
They got to do it with play action. So I think their job is to, their thing is to come out and give you a heavy dose of Derrick Henry. And it's crazy that in the NFL, a guy that can get stronger as the game goes on. Most of the time, you've been pounded on enough that by then you're starting to shut it down as far as running backs are concerned. But as the game goes on, but in his case, as the game goes on, he gets stronger and stronger and stronger. So,
and he was like that at Bama. And I was watching high school highlights of him last night. And you look at the highlights on the NFL, and you're like, it hadn't changed much from high school to college to NFL. And that says a lot because you don't normally see that kind of dominance.
And they were giving him like 35 carries a game in high school.
Well, remember the last two games of the year in 15 when he went to Auburn and carried the ball 45 times and then another 35 against Florida the next week for nearly 500 yards. So, I mean, but 180 yards in the last three games has never been done in NFL history. I mean, this is rarefied air that Derrick Henry's in right now.
Antonio, how would you feel as a DB if Derrick Henry's coming at you in the secondary?
Gotta get him down, don't you?
My job would be to get him down, but as I've watched some of these games here lately, everybody seems to be bailing out of that idea of trying to tackle him. I even saw Earl Thomas. Now, everybody knows how aggressive Earl Thomas is, and he seemed to be retreating a little bit when Derrick Henry turned that corner, and then he stiffed arm and then pushed him in the back. So a lot of times these guys,
Marlon was chasing him too, and Marlon was like, I think I'm gonna let him try to tackle him. I'll keep
him. Well, Marlon had let it be known early in the week that the idea of tackling Derrick Henry is not one that he really wanted to think about.
He's already done it in the past, practice.
I mean, I guess with a guy like that, you just got to throw your body in there and close your eyes, bro.
Go low. You better go for the ankles because the knees will hurt you, and that stiff arm he's so long. I mean, that's the thing about it. And then his strides start going, and man, it's just
powerful dude, man. And I love his attitude. They ask him about it, and he just goes, man, we just want to win. I just want to win the next game. That's all that matters. Look, I just want to win. And Mike Vrabel, we hadn't talked about him enough. Man, what a great job he has done with that football team. Bill Belichick, kind of disciple. We know about his history of the Ohio State and playing with the Patriots. But, man, what a great job Mike Vrabel's done with this football team.
All right, we'll get back into that and much more. And congratulations. I saw where it came out. Lynette Starr, Christian Story, named Alabama's Mr. Football, the Crimson Tide signee. So congratulations to Christian Story, again, Alabama's Mr. Football. And also, Patrick Nix is heading to Central Phoenix City. We haven't hit on that today. And he'll be closer now to Bo Nix at Auburn. So he leaves Pinson Valley for Central Phoenix City, and they've got some unbelievable talent. Do they not, Antonio?
Oh, my goodness.
It may win state championship after state championship down there. All right, a lot going on, and we'll continue. I want to remind you, for a dollar a day, Cardiac Solutions can help as far as saving lives. They're all about it. Along with their partners, they've developed world-class AED programs across North America for more than a decade, including deployments for multiple Fortune 500 companies. They offer a comprehensive portfolio of AED program solutions. AEDs are defibrillators, and this includes the AEDs, the AED trainers, accessories, program compliance training, and AED monitoring. Cardiac Solutions is your trusted AED program partner. To learn more, just go online at cardiac-solutions.net. That's cardiac-solutions.net. For a dollar a day, it can save lives. All right, we'll continue live from AVX. You're listening to The Jay Barker Show. We'll be back.
You're listening to The Jay Barker Show, live from the AVX studios in downtown Birmingham.
With the AFC NFC Championship games coming up this weekend, and also got the Super Bowl coming up as well. And the game tonight, Alabama and Auburn down at Coleman Coliseum. You can watch it at Baumhauer's Victory Grill. They've been serving up legendary fun and legendary food for nearly 40 years. Their full menu of scratch-made American classics, all your game day favorites, plus the wall-to-wall TV, state-of-the-art sound systems at Baumhauer's Victory Grill. It is game day every day. And don't forget the new location in Vestavia. That's Baumhauer's Victory Grill, legendary fun and legendary food. Antonio Langham, Lars Anderson, Scott Moore, iTalk SEC. I'm Jay Barker, and we're live at AVX, audio video excellence. And Antonio, this weekend, the Walter Camp All-American Banquet's going on. You'll be flying up tomorrow and got the tux ready. You'll be celebrating. Tell us a little bit about what this banquet's all about, and you've been attending it for many years.
Well, the Walter Camp Football Foundation, the All-American deal is each year, Walter Camp Foundation, they select number of guys out of college football, which you all know, to be on the All-American team. And I think this year they are honoring, I think Joe Burrow is Player of the Year. I think Coach Orgeron is the Coach of the Year. I think Von Miller is Man of the Year. I know Chris Berman would be honored as a distinguished guy, but I know all those guys, but I don't actually know who's on the team this year. But I get a chance to meet a lot of those guys this weekend while we're there. It's a lot of fun. They always invite the alumni to come, and the guys who made it in the past who want to come, they invite them back to come in. And it's just a good time. We all just go out and we visit hospitals during that weekend and children's hospitals and all that good stuff. So it's a lot of fun. The weekend is a lot of fun. So
I think from an historical perspective, to be able to be on that team and then to be able to go back year in and year out and kind of give back. I mean, we just celebrated the 150th anniversary of college football, and I think going back and being able to be part of stuff like that's got to be incredibly special to you and to the guys that take their time to go back. I mean, what an honor to have the opportunity and go back and be part of this every year. I think that's really, really, really special.
And it's a lot of fun, man. A lot of the guys that I made the team with, Deuce was on the Walter Camp All-American team with me, David Palmer and Corey Sawyer. A lot of guys that get to hang out with Big Hugh Green. He's crazy. And a lot of those guys.
He was awfully good, too.
Yes, man. Those guys, they're a lot of fun to be around. So you just see a bunch of guys sitting around telling old stories, and they get better and they get bigger with time. So the Walter Camp deal, it's a lot of fun. And you get to meet these young guys that make the team, and they want to ask y'all kind of questions about the NFL and how it works and how to survive in it and the whole nine. So it's good to sit around and get those guys some words of wisdom.
Some other news coming out today. Alabama and Georgia Tech have decided to do a home-and-home series for the 2030 and 2031 year. So it's going to be at Tech at 2030 and 10 years from now, and at Tuscaloosa in 2031. And if you look at, as far as the record, 28 wins for Alabama, 21 wins for Georgia Tech, and 3 ties. Largest margin of victory is with 1934 was 40-0. Longest win streak was 5 for the Crimson Tide, from 33 to 37. And longest win streak for Georgia Tech from 1954 to 57. Largest margin of victory for Georgia Tech was 36-0 back in 1910.
You will be in year 31 of our radio career by then. But
right, right. Now, hey, we'll still be going strong in 2030. But, you know, in chasing the bear book, I've discovered that this used to be a huge rivalry.
It was. It was a nasty rivalry. With Herman Bischer in Atlanta, writing for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
Bryant wore helmets.
He sure did. Yeah. These two teams hated each other. And there's a lot of, you know, Galen McCullough will talk about
that. It was crazy to think that Bear Bryant had to wear a helmet out onto the field during pregame warm-ups because they were throwing bottles at him.
Because Bryant said that he would never spend a dime in the city of Atlanta or the state of Georgia. He said, when I go there, I take my lunch pail with me. I'm not spending a single penny in the city or around. I'm assuming they're not going to play that game at Grant Field. Yeah. They'll probably play that in the Mercedes-Benz Dome. So that'll be good. If you've ever been to Grant Field, you know, it's not a very good place to go to a football game. It's a little bit aged.
Yeah, no, and there was a lot of accusations of dirty play on both sides.
The chicken running incident.
Especially on the Alabama side. And there was a
Darwin Holt and Chick Graining.
There was a perception that Bryant's players were just borderline dirty. And but really, you know what they were? Tough. And that's all Bryant wanted out of his players was toughness. I think toughness is the one word that would be best used to describe Bear Bryant's team and tenure at Alabama, and was the hallmark of all of his teams, because they weren't necessarily the most talented guys, but man, they were tough.
Well, Alabama would play Georgia. They'd also play Georgia Tech. You had that opener, I think it was in 1964, when Georgia's wide receiver had his knees on the ground. They did the pitch out, and you know, had we had instant replay, of course, we didn't even have television back then. But that was a crazy game in the history. And but there was so much animosity between Georgia, Georgia Tech, and Alabama. That's why the schedule makers got together and said, maybe we shouldn't play this game. And it's one of the reasons Alabama and Georgia play every 8 or 9 years. They'll play again in Tuscaloosa this year. But that rivalry and the way the SEC East and West, the way it was set up, had a lot to do with everything that went on in Atlanta, Georgia in the 60s and 70s between Alabama and Georgia Tech and Georgia.
Doesn't it feel like, just speaking about Georgia real quick, doesn't it feel like Georgia was kind of supposed to be the next team in the SEC?
Yeah.
And they got leapfrogged by LSU?
Yeah, no doubt. And not only did they get leapfrogged, they got beat soundly by LSU the last 2 years too. So, you know, listen, expectations, when you start getting them, Antonio, and everybody's expecting you because you've recruited well to go just automatically go win a national title, just because you recruit well doesn't mean that guarantees you a national championship. It guarantees you you'll be in the discussion. But, hey, man, I thought Georgia had a lot of chemistry issues in that program this year. A lot, 14 guys didn't play in the bowl game. Antonio said it in hour one. If you're going to be on the team, then go out and play for your football team. 14 guys set that bowl game out, and 7 of them have already gone on to the NFL.
I'm still at a loss if – You're giving a scholarship to play. I understand these guys and their logic. To play football, and I understand their logic. And I understand the idea of getting hurt right at the end when you're getting ready for your the combine and the NFL and all that. But what are you doing? All you're doing is training, lifting weights, running the whole night, getting ready.
So you can play football.
So you can play football. There's accidents can happen while you're training. There have been guys torn Achilles in the whole night. If you're there, on an athletic scholarship football, play. Finish the season out. I mean, I understand that logic, and some people will be like, well, if he was in that situation, he may skip a bowl game, this and that. But the idea of it is this. You're there. Finish it out with your guys.
Like Jerry Jeudy, 232 yards, a career day for him.
You look at as far as just the history of this team, and Tulane was another one of those teams. Swanee.
Yeah.
I mean, thinking back to all the old teams from the SEC. But 1984 was the last matchup and meeting between Alabama and Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech won that game 16-6.
That was a bad day at the office. That was following the Boston College loss, and they lost Kerry Goode. Now Alabama went to Atlanta and Grant Field and a little bit flat. And Bill Curry was the head football coach of that football team for Georgia Tech. So,
all right, we'll take a quick break. We'll finish up hour number two. Antonio Langham, Lars Anderson, Scott Moore from MyTalk SEC. I'm Jay Barker. You're listening to the Jay Barker Show live from AVX Audio Video Excellence. We'll be back.
You're listening to the Jay Barker Show live from the AVX Studios in downtown Birmingham.
Hey, get out to the Cajun Steamer. If you can't get out to the Cajun Steamer as far as for lunch or dinner, you can also pre-book your crawfish bowl. Don't forget, crawfish season is just around the corner. Available for pickup and delivery, 844-2GO. That's 844-T-O-G-E-A-U-X. And their Mardi Gras special going on as well. Fat Tuesday this year on February 25th, celebrating with drinks, specials, live music, Mardi Gras, swag, and much more. You don't want to miss it. And also, as far as all their special events, follow them on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter today, @Cajun_Steamer, in order to find out what's going on. And don't forget about the brunch on Saturday and Sunday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Handcrafted brunch, menu, drink specials, and perfect excuse to have Sunday fun day all weekend long out at the Cajun Steamer, and locations all throughout our listening area. All right, as far as the game coming up tonight, and breaking it down earlier with Brian Pasink at 1 o'clock, he joined us, the color analyst of the Crimson Tide. Number 4 Auburn is coming in to Coleman Coliseum to face up against the Crimson Tide. And man, since Bruce Pearl got there, has really turned this program around. And as you talked about, their last loss in the Final Four of last year, they've been undefeated this year. But Nate Oates right now doing a terrific job of getting this Alabama team playing at number one at a lot different tempo than we've seen. Is right now they're ranked 3rd in the nation in tempo, 1st as far as SEC and 3-point shooting. So he's doing some changes that should be up tempo tonight on both sides of this rivalry, and should be a lot of points scored tonight. Should be a shootout.
I'll tell you this: if Auburn, if they're going to get beat, it's going to get beat tonight, because the toughest thing to do, you guys know this, in the SEC in basketball and in college basketball, toughest thing to do is win on the road. It is so hard to go into a rival and win, especially one that shoots the three as well as Alabama does. That's the thing that could keep Alabama in it is the three ball tonight. They'll shoot a truckload of them. If they can have a little bit better success than they did against Kentucky and have the same type of effort that they got against Florida, everything was going down against Florida. If they can get out to a lead here and be able to get the crowd into the ball game, that to me is going to be the secret tonight. Again, Auburn's favored by 2.5. They are a really, really great team. But Alabama's got a really good chance to win this ball game tonight. And here's the other thing. They need to win this game tonight because the difference between 1-3 in the SEC and 2-2 is the difference between maybe getting an NCAA tournament bid. This would go a long way to helping Alabama get the tournament.
Do you think their NCAA tournament hopes are on life support right now?
No, I don't, because this is an early – the schedule was so top-heavy for this team. And they're going to get better. And I think the schedule lightens up after you get through this week. So they got a chance to, I think, get back on track. And tonight would be a really, really good start. But they need to win this ball game for a number of reasons. It's your rival. You got them at home. And Nate Oates trying to send a message to Bruce Pearl and company that, hey, you got somebody to deal with now. This is a big opportunity tonight for Alabama basketball.
And it's a team, Antonio, that can get hot from three-point land, but at the same time, they're really effective at dribble drive and get to the basket.
Man.
And so, you know, you kind of have to pick your poison. If they're hot tonight, then make them drive. If they're not, then make them shoot the three ball and contest it. They have not been as good as Alabama from three-point as far as being effective this year.
Lars, I don't think they're on life support, but I think they got a defibrillator out, though.
I do. We got a cardiac solution for them. Yeah.
That's why you got to get the 2-2. Yeah, tonight. Yeah, this is a big opportunity for Alabama to kind of turn the corner, and then you got all of January and February. But you're right, Antonio, that he's out there. The defibrillator guy's out there. But if you can win tonight, I really think it's a big boost, and you got a chance to get a lot of momentum tonight.
I agree, and I think that's what those kids need. A big win like that tonight can boost their confidence and get them rolling. Like we're saying, they're getting better.
Yeah.
And they're getting and they're understanding and they're starting to get comfortable with the new head coach and the offense and the schemes that he's running for as a basketball program concern. Now they need one of those games where they get out there and they get up, they get down, and they finish and win the game. And I think that'll be a big boost for them moving forward.
Officially, the game has just been announced by Alabama as a sellout. So it is a sellout. So it'll be crazy in T-Town tonight.
I know my students are really looking forward to it. This is one of those games that you circle on the calendar and you make sure to go to.
You got two extra?
I'm looking for you, man. I'm trying to use my faculty connection.
Between all of us in here, we should be able to find at least two tickets, right?
Anybody out there, y'all hit Jay Scott up, Lars on Twitter, and let them know y'all got us all covered.
Yeah.
Y'all got a name on the list tonight to get in the game.
That's right.
Go down to the game tonight, jump on the plane tomorrow.
There you go.
Take off to the All-American.
There you go.
Walk sounds camp. Good, baby.
For Alabama, though, tonight, and you talked about as far as the tournament, and that's the goal, right? I mean, Nate talked about, you know, we want to make the tournament, and if you beat a team like Auburn tonight, that is huge on the resume. And here's the other thing, not only the confidence level, because I think even if they play them close tonight and even if they lose, you're right, as far as early in the season, the competition they've gone up against so far, that's going to build a lot into them as a team, the way that they're having to kind of, you know, group together and the chemistry of the team, but more importantly, their play, because the competition is going to get lighter. And so they've been tested. They know what they've got to do to either sustain a lead or to get back in a game or to play against top teams like Kentucky and Auburn right now in the SEC.
Well, they got Missouri, Vandy, K-State, and LSU up next, and then Arkansas and Tennessee at home. You go to Georgia, Auburn down there, then LSU, A&M, Ole Miss, all coming to Tuscaloosa. So this start, I mean, to have to open up playing Florida, at Florida, and then Kentucky at Kentucky, the first two Saturday games. Alabama got probably the toughest draw of anybody in the league having to do that. And then Auburn at home. So, I mean, you've had to play three really good teams in a row here. So, but Lars, a big opportunity for them with the schedule right now. They're sitting at 8-7. You get a win tonight, you're 9-7 with a chance to get some momentum, maybe get to 13-7, 14-7. And then you're really talking, okay, there's an opportunity. I think an 18-12 record is possible right now. If you get to 18 and 12 going to the SEC tournament, you got a real good shot, I think, of getting in. I think there's 16.
If you win two games in the SEC tournament, get to 20, then you probably got a shot to get in.
Yeah, because they played a very difficult schedule, the non-conference with Penn State and others. So, yeah, I think everybody's excited about this game tonight.
Be a good matchup. Hey, one of the things we didn't hit on, I wanted to hit on, we get about a minute and a half, but Drew Pearson, man, his reaction
to
not getting into the Hall of Fame, man, he's a little upset there, wasn't he, Antonio?
Yeah, I don't know the words he used, but if you could replay it and read lips, I'm pretty sure he is not happy at all about it.
I don't blame him. I'm surprised he's not in. I mean, he's certainly got the statistics and the big stage and all that. I mean, I don't know, man.
My man Ken Anderson didn't get in either. Four-time passing champion. My uncle.
I don't know if acting like that, though, is going to get you in.
No.
I don't either.
Discourage them from even, you know, just take it gracefully and realize that, hey, you can maybe get another shot. But just to be mentioned in that, just to be a part of that and being nominated is a huge deal.
Yeah, you have a press conference, though, and you show up, you think you're getting in, and then you don't.
I know, yeah.
I don't think I'd wait on the press conference.
It looked more like a draft party with all his family.
Or you're signing with somebody.
All right, have a great Wednesday, and hopefully the Coleman Coliseum will be packed tonight for number four, Auburn, coming in to Coleman Coliseum to face up against Nate Oates and his Alabama basketball team. Back tomorrow here live from AVX, audio, video, excellence for our Thursday edition of the Jay Barker Show. From Lars Anderson, Scott Moore, iTalk, SEC, Antonio Langham, I'm Jay Barker. Thanks to Josh Smith as well, producing the show as always, and have a great Wednesday. We'll see you tomorrow.